please know in your program, you have an invitation to our Easter services. That's not for you, ultimately. I want you to take it. But it's in the end intended for you to hand off to a friend or a family member, a coworker or a neighbor, that they could be invited into our Easter gatherings to hear afresh about the resurrection of Jesus and the good news, the gospel, that God is reconciling the world to himself through his son, Jesus. And so, please, invite somebody to join us on Easter. Also, please take note that as we open Easter week, we have a Passover Seder on Passover Eve, which is Monday evening of the Passion Week. You'll see in your program an outline of the Passion Week. If you've never heard of the Passion Week, that's the final week of the life of Jesus, culminating in his death, burial, and resurrection. We created this resource for you so that you could walk through the Passion Week, seeing the biblical texts that relate to the days of that week. And so we're gathering on Monday night and a Passover Seder. We're gathering Friday night on Good Friday, the day in which we remember specifically Jesus on the cross. And then, of course, we celebrate our victory on Resurrection Sunday. So please take note of all of that. If you want to come to the Passover Seder, we only have 200 spots available, and they are almost all taken. You need to sign up on our website. So I'd recommend you do that tonight. You can do that by just going to mc4s.org, and you can register for the Passover Seder. In fact, would you go ahead and do this? I want you to take your phone out on purpose. Some of you who have attended the previous sessions or this morning services, you already know this. So forgive me for repetition, but we do have some who are new to us just this evening. So mc4s.org, and the very first banner you'll see, it says Downloadable Teaching Notes by Dr. Randy Smith. Those will help you. Dr. Randy prepared 6 teachings for us that constitute 107 pages of notes. Okay? That just gives you an idea as to the content. And you will be able to follow along with his notes tonight as you download that. You're going to want to scroll all the way down to session 6, probably somewhere around page 90. I didn't look specifically. 103. There you go. So 103, and you can follow along tonight. Tonight, Dr. Smith is going to walk us through the message of Revelation. And so we will get to glean from that. Obviously, a book that mystifies a fair amount of us, and yet, as we'll hear from his teaching, a book of great victory and great hope. So, let me tell you a little bit about our dear Dr. Randy Smith. I think we can call him that now, our dear Dr. Randy Smith. This is his 6th time teaching us. He's taken over 50 of us already to Israel, and our Israel meeting this afternoon is kind of dynamo, standing room only. So we have a lot of us considering going to Israel with Randy in 2018. Randy pastors a church in Florida. He has a Bible Institute that he leads. He is the founder and teacher of Christian Travel Studies program, which about half of the year is either in Israel or Italy. Israel, obviously, we're in the Holy Land. We're looking at the biblical text, Old and New Testament alike. But then also he takes groups to Italy to walk through the New Testament and specifically follow in the footsteps of the Apostle Paul. So this man is a world traveler. He's a teacher extraordinaire. If you haven't heard him yet, you are in for a treat. There are very few people that I like to listen to as much as Dr. Smith in terms of content of teaching. He's dynamic. He makes the biblical text come alive. There's a lot else I could tell you about him, but I just want you to come to Israel and find it out for yourself, okay? And really, we invited Dr. Smith to be with us towards that goal, that you would hear his teaching here in person, and whether it be in 18 or 20 or 22, as God would give us opportunity, I would really like for you to begin to think and plan and pray around that. We're committed to this. Dr. Smith is committed to this. So without taking any more of his time, would you welcome with me Dr. Randy Smith? You're going
to
need that.
I have to tell you, I'm going to begin with a confession. There is not another guy in this room who was more lame at dating than me, ever, on the planet. And I have to tell you that, I mean, I could have won an award for how lame I was at dating. But there was this one time, I was so afraid of this girl because she was way too cute for me. Now, I don't know if you guys still do this, but back in the dark ages before the wheel, like when I was in school, we had this rating system. Now, everybody had their own, and no one could ever tell anybody what theirs was. But the rating system was people that were, like, in my zone, people that were, like, way above my zone, and people like, oh, no, I'm not going there. Well, this girl was, like, way above my zone. You know what I'm saying? And I was terrified of her. Add to that, she was quiet. Now, I don't know if, I mean, there's some of you that are young. I'm just going to say this. The quiet ones impress you as being holy. They're not. They're just quiet. That's all. Some of them are quiet because they got nothing to say, okay? But I didn't know that, so I was so intimidated. I asked this girl for a date, and she said yes. And I was so excited. And we went to some cheesy place because it's what I could afford. And when we got there, something happened to this quiet young lady. I'm not sure exactly what it is, but I've seen it in my own two daughters. It was like someone fired a gun and told her to start speaking, and no one told her to take a breath, and she was off. And it was like those Charlie Brown things where the adults show up. Wah, 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 wah. I didn't know what she was talking about. And after 3 minutes, I knew more than I ever wanted to know about this girl. Has anybody ever had a TMI date? Like, way more information than I ever wanted to know about you. Thank you. Do you ever have somebody walk up and start talking to you and they start telling you something? You're never going to remember it. You don't know who they are and you're not sure why they're telling you the details of their life. This happens to me in malls. I don't know why. But here's what I know. I know that when you get too much information, you get overwhelmed and you shut down. I don't want to scare you tonight. But when you open up the last book of the Bible, most people I know get scared. Now, you don't need to get scared. You know what? I'm going to grab this table right here and bring it up here. I'm not going to throw it at you. You don't need to get scared, but I want you to think through something with me. The end of the Bible, the final book of the Bible, the book we call the book of Revelation, is, in fact, a really unique book. It is designed to expose something that the rest of the Bible tries to do in very poetic and drawn-out terms. It's a scalpel-sharp exhibition of who Jesus is. This book isn't just about the future things. It's about Jesus in the future things. Because you don't want to go to the future where Jesus isn't. That's not the good future. You're looking for the other one. And what I can tell you is this book opens and gives me incredible information. I gotta tell you, I hate surprises. I hate surprises. I do. This is one of the reasons I don't like to fly. I really don't. And I got on a flight, and I was heading across Nicaragua. And I'm in this little airplane, and the very first thing the pilot did in the flight was take the newspaper and cover the entire windscreen of the front of the plane. This did not make me feel better. Because my feeling is, if I'm coming toward a mountain, I want to know before I hit it. He's looking at this little radar thing. That doesn't tell me anything. I want to know where we're going. I hate surprises. The last book of the Bible was designed so that you wouldn't be surprised. I spend 16 hours to go through this book normally with my 20-year-old students. And that's, I'll be back in the classroom Tuesday teaching all day. This is what I do. They absolutely drive me wild, but I love them. This is the first of the 16 hours, and I'm not even going to do an hour. This isn't designed to give you every detail of Revelation. It's designed to get you to not be afraid and to date the book in 45 minutes. You know, on the first date, you shouldn't come back and know their whole life story. And in just a quick half-hour pass through a book, you're not going to know everything about it. But let's dive in for a minute. Take a look at chapter 1, if you will. The time was the waning years of the first century. Most of the apostles had died for their faith. Emperor Domitian, who was from 81 to 96 A.D. or C.E., he had exiled John to a penal colony that was sitting out in the middle of the Aegean Sea, a little rock, and the problem with Patmos is it has no water supply. Even today, a ship brings all the water to that island. There is no natural water source on the island whatsoever. Now, John was there. He's working in a penal colony, and apparently he's been put there because he was the pastor of the church at Ephesus. And he feels like, probably, that this is kind of a long pause and perhaps end swan song of his ministry, because usually people don't go to prison in the Roman Empire and then come back and write a great book. But John didn't know what Jesus was going to do. What's interesting is that the letter is incredibly unique in the respect that it has its own internal outline. Drop your eyes to chapter 1, verse 19. I want you to notice that the book has an outline. Jesus is telling John what to write. And he says, because of what you've seen, therefore, write the things which you have seen. Put a little number one in your mind right next to that. And the things which are, that's number two. And third, the things which shall be. In Greek, it says meta tauta, after the things which are. Now, what's interesting is chapter 1, verses 1 through 18 is everything he saw before verse 19. That makes sense, right? So if you write the things that you've seen, what did he see? The first part of the book is the vision of the risen Christ. Then write the things which are in chapters 2 and 3, seven letters to seven actual churches that were functioning at the time of John. And then in chapter 4, verse 1, it begins meta tauta, after the things which are, tipping you off that from chapter 4 to 22 is the third part of the book. Now, when you look at the book, all I'm trying to get you to see is that the cause of the book is given in the first three verses. What's the book for? Well, if you read the first three verses, it is number one in verse one to show Jesus. Number two is to show things that are going to happen because of Jesus. And number three, there's something really strange about this book. Did you see the word? He sent it and communicated it by his angel. The word communicated is the word semeion. It's the word that some translations make signified, encoded. Here's what's weird about this book. Some of the stuff in the book is designed to be coded. Now, some of them are obvious, like, out of the bottomless pit came a locust with the face of a man with a breastplate of iron. What is it? I don't know, but if you see one, run, okay? What do you need? What's your problem? But the point is that some of it is supposed to be deliberately encoded. Some of it's more nuanced than that. I noticed that in verse 4 through 8, it also tells me about the collaboration of the book. Who wrote the book? Well, you got to have a writer, so John's the writer. But it also says the Father who was sitting on the throne was one who was to write the book. The Spirit of God was there to help write the book. And finally, Jesus was there to write the book. In other words, the Trinity was working with John. Wow, talk about getting some writing partners. John really had it all together. And then the circumstances in verses 9 and 10. In chapter 1 and verses 9 and 10, it says, I was stuck on Patmos, in prison, in worship. Wait a minute. You were stuck on Patmos, but you were in worship. See, the Bible says that any place can be a holy place and any time a holy time. There are no God-forsaken places and there are no God-forsaken people. There are people that forsake God, but there are no God-forsaken people. And here he was, he stopped. Right in the middle of the most discouraging time in your ministry. I got to tell you, I don't know any pastor anywhere who says, I can't wait till they arrest me and throw me in prison. I don't know anybody like that. So I'm thinking, he's thinking, this is not a good time. But that's when God used him at his greatest. So just remember this, when you feel like you've been put on a shelf, maybe you haven't. God might be about to do the greatest thing through your life. By the way, in verses 11 to 18, the commissioning was from Jesus. What do you see about Jesus? What you see is he's walking like the seven, in between seven lampstands or lighthouses of the truth. He's walking dressed like a priest because Hebrews 7 says that he's our intercessor, and his hair is white and his eyes are flashing like light, and his feet are like copper and burnished bronze, and out of his mouth comes a sharp sword. Now, don't get weird. Bing! It's not a sword. It's metaphor. I want you to be open to an idea when you're reading the book that some stuff stunned John. And he didn't really know what it was. Would you all be open to the idea that John in the first century didn't know what an interballistic missile looked like? We okay with that? So when he says something dropped from heaven, it was hard like hail and it blew up. I'm good with that. He doesn't have another, I saw a crystal city. The guy's never seen any of the West Coast cities. He doesn't know what a big city looks like. It looks like crystal because it's glass. He's looking forward without words to describe what he sees. So don't get all weirded out by it. And it finally, he says, and there's the contents of the book in 119 and then the curiosity in 120. If you take a look at verse 20 of chapter 1, here's what it says. It says, as for the mystery of the seven stars which you saw in my right hand and the seven golden lampstands, the seven stars are seven angels of the seven churches, and the seven lampstands are the seven churches. Here's what he's saying. The curiosity of the book is often you'll see something and you won't know what it is. Keep reading. A little later he goes, by the way, you know the thing you saw? This is what it was. That's the curiosity of Revelation. Don't stop on the verse and go, I wonder what that is. How do you feel? What do you think it is? Read down, because probably five verses later he goes, you know that weird thing I just told you? This is what it was. Now, when you go to chapters 2 and 3, you get to seven churches that existed at the time of John. You can learn these. It's not so hard. Everybody sing, please. That sounds pretty lovely. Everybody sing, please. That sounds pretty lovely. Everybody, Ephesus, sing Smyrna, please, Pergamum. That Thyatira sounds Sardis, pretty Philadelphia, lovely Laodicea. You can also say, everybody sing, please, that sounds pretty lousy. It depends on who you're teaching, but I knew you had good voices, so here's what I'm saying. If you take a look at what happens in chapters 2 and 3, it's in the order of the postal route of the first century. That's why they're in that order. Now, I do a tour in Western Turkey to those seven cities. It's one you can come on later. It's a fun tour. We're not doing it this year because Turkey's in a bit of a mess. But bottom line is that in chapter 2, 1 through 7, I go to the magnificent port city of Ephesus that's no longer a port because it got silted up and now you have to walk all the way out to the beach. But at the time, they were the city of love, and they had neglected their heart, and so Jesus had a word for them. If you go 40 miles north in the bus, in about an hour, you can get up to the city of Smyrna. It's a port city with an upper city and a lower city, and the lighted walls around the top look like this golden crown, and that's in the letter. And what's wonderful is that they were so afraid that their fear was killing their faithfulness. So Jesus had to write them. John had to write to the third city, about an hour and a half inland, just up the coast. You go along Pergamene marble and you come to this. If you've ever seen a Prudential commercial, you know that big rock? Okay, that's what this looks like. It's sitting on top of this big rock. There are about 20 switchbacks to go up the road in the bus. Lots of fun. You got to remember, I'm sitting in the guide seat. It hangs over the side when we make the turns. So I just always tell everybody, if you get scared, close your eyes. That's what the driver's doing, and it seems to be working for him really well. But you get up to the top of that, and you realize that they were tolerating error, and that was muting them from standing up and being counted. I could jump back on the bus, and I can go another 60 miles inland, and I could take you to the Hephaestus Temple, and there I could show you these huge, huge columns that stood up in the middle of the temple that was sitting at Sardis. And there you would see on the mosaics of the floor all kinds of pictures of people having banquets and sex at the same time, because that was their world. That's what the hall was for. And you knew that because it was on the floor. Now, the crazy part about it is that the believers there were complacent and weren't standing up, so Jesus had to write them a letter. And I could jump you back into the bus, and I could take you down past Sardis and get you all the way back into Philadelphia and take you to the worst excavation that you'll see on the whole trip. Philadelphia, the excavation could fit in this room. The problem with Philadelphia is it sits right on a major fault line. So there's literally a column in the center that was stood up, and it says, this column was erected by Yohanan, scratched out, Marcus, scratched out. And they kept falling over, they kept picking it back up, and another guy put his name on there. Philadelphia, the most knocked down city in the New Testament. Why? It's sitting in an earthquake zone. And what did Jesus say? Hang in there, guys, and I'll give you a temple that doesn't fall. Because Jesus had something to say. Don't be intimidated by your small size. I could take you up to Laodicea, one of my favorite spots. If you go to Laodicea, you're inside this little town, and if I look this way, I can see German tourists naked, all because they're always that way, up in, they're in Pamukkala. It's a bunch of calcified springs. They're like white springs. They look like snow, but it's all hot springs. And there's always Germans there, and they're running around. And then if I turn this, that's not the exciting part. It's the place, not them. Now, if I turn around and I look back the other way, I can see the Taurus Mountains and the snow cap on them. And halfway between the hot springs and the cold mountains is Laodicea. Halfway between hot and cold. And Jesus had a letter to write to them. So chapters 2 and 3 are dealing with heart problems of real church issues going on at the time that John had been a pastor at Ephesus, which was kind of like the mother church of all the others. So God called on him to do something. Now, from chapter 4, verse 1, all the way through the end of the book, there's a very simple design to this book. You have to know something about John to understand how John writes. What's another big book that the apostle John wrote before this one? The Gospel of John. Good, because if you didn't get that, I'm really worried, okay? Now, the thing is, if you read the Gospel of John, it's actually 7 I am sayings. I am the good shepherd, I am the door, I am the way, the truth, and the life, I am the resurrection. 7 things Jesus said about who he is matched with 7 things Jesus did. So he raises this person, he heals this person, 7 things he did, 7 things he said, 7 and 7, that's a John book. Now when you get to Revelation, cut the book in half. How many of you have ever seen the very frustrating story called 24? I hate split screen. And I don't want to watch something that gets me so worked up that by the time I'm trying to go to bed, I'm to spend an extra 40 minutes. I don't count sheep. I have goats. 1, 2. That's what I got. That's it. I'm done. So chapter 4 through chapter 22 are 7 shots on earth and 7 shots in heaven, split screen. Now, if you follow it, heaven shot number 1 is in chapters 4 and 5. And it cuts from these 7 churches. And it goes up into heaven and it shows you how many personages do you think are seen in chapters 4 and 5? 7. Very good. Now this is great. We're catching on right away. So what we have is John is told to come up in the beginning of chapter 4, and he sees in 4:3 the Father sitting on the throne, surrounded by a crystal sea, and around him are the 24 elders, and they're representative of people of all nations and tongues and kindreds and tribes who have been saved. I know they're saved, and I know they're judged, and I know they're resurrected by what they're wearing and what they're singing. They're singing, yay, you saved us, which means they're saved, okay? And they're also standing there in white linen, and later on it'll tell you that that's the righteousness of the saints. So there they're standing there in 4:11. And what's interesting to me is the seven spirits of God are around the throne. And some of you are going, wait a minute, I thought there was just this Holy Spirit. In Isaiah 11, he has seven different names. If you'd like to look them up, just look up Isaiah 11, mark it in your Bible, and go back and look. So the seven spirits of God are around the throne. Who else is there? There are these four living creatures, the four weird-looking creatures. These are seraphim, if I understand Ezekiel chapter 1 properly in 4:6. There's also a strong angel that's mentioned three times in the book. He's probably Michael, the archangel. You might be interested to know there's only one named archangel in the Bible. All the other ones came from Catholic tradition. The only one in the Bible named as an archangel is Michael, and he's specially attached to the people of Israel. But you'll see him here, you'll see him again in Revelation 10 and again in Revelation 15. But then the lion, who is also the lamb. And what's interesting is where he is. He's not up on the throne, he's out with the people. He's mingling amongst them. And in chapters 4 and 5, I can't tell you who it is. I think it's some kid in the 14th row. I'm not really sure. But somebody starts off and says, what's that scroll? As a scroll is delivered. Who's worthy to open the scroll? And when I stood there and saw it, John says, I wept in chapter 5, verse 2. I cried because I couldn't think of anybody who would be worthy to open the scroll of the coming of the rest of human history and finish the human program. And then somebody said it, worthy is the Lamb. 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 And the room, the largest stadium you've ever seen in your life, filled with people of every kindred and tongue and nation and tribe, are filled saying, worthy is the Lamb. Worthy is the Lamb. Worthy is the Lamb. And then the Lamb shows up, and it's a good thing because they were running out of voice. Now, I don't know if you've ever seen a scroll, but you don't put a scroll with seven, like, wax seals on the outside of a scroll. That's not how you do it. Scrolls were often sent to groups of people, and each person was rated more and more secret than the other people. So the first part of the scroll would have a piece of wax seal. When you broke that, you could read only part of the scroll, and then there was another wax seal. You'd have to break the second one to get more. And the third one to get more, to unfurl the scroll. But what you're supposed to know is that when Jesus unfurls the scroll in chapter 6, it's the beginning, not from heaven now, but from heaven to the earth. And there's an earth shot here. And on earth, as he opens the scroll, each seal that breaks becomes a judgment on the earth. The earth is not going to be pummeled by a lack of ecology. We're not going to mess it up so bad that that's what ruins it. This is coming from heaven, and you're not stopping it. So it says in chapter 6 that he opens up the seal, and first this one who goes out, it becomes this victor, a conqueror, and he goes out and he causes a war, which causes famine, which causes a quarter of the earth to die. And then, stop, hold button. There's a fifth seal that's broken, where God says, hold it. I want you to protect this group of my evangelists, this 144,000 evangelists that are running around on the earth. Leave them alone until I tell you that the mark is off of them, and then you can kill them. But they're mine until they're done. Guys, you are indestructible until Jesus is done with you. It doesn't matter what's going on. You're indestructible till Jesus is done with you. And when he's done with you, you're done. So here it says that they were sent as evangelists. And in chapter 7, it even enumerates 144,000 of them, each of these from 12,000 from 12 tribes. Chapter 6 tells me in verses 12 to 17 that there's people that are so overwhelmed by what's going on the earth as the beginning of these judgments have come that they're running into shelters and saying, close the door, put us down here, we're done, we can't do this anymore. And they try to go underground, but it doesn't work. Now, you're going to get used to this. Right in the middle of the pummeling of the earth, we go to heaven. And here's what you get. Praise. Nobody is up in heaven going, Wait a minute, that's my car. Don't do that. No, you don't care. Heaven does not have a complaint department. Do you know why? There are no complaints. Why? Because when you look into the eyes of fire, you're going to know he knows what he's doing. Besides that, you're going to be like Dorothy standing before the Wizard of Oz. Like, what are you going to walk up and... No, I don't think so. Father of the ages versus you. So here's what I see. The heaven shot is filled with praise. And from 7:9 to 8:6, here's what you have. You have people standing there. And what are they holding in their hands as they're singing? Palm branches. I wear some coins from the Roman period. The one that I wear is part of the Judaea Capta coins. The symbol of Israel in the antiquity was a palm branch. Why? Because the tribulation was going on earth in order to purify and finally bring Israel to its knees. And so from heaven, the church was singing and waving palm branches and singing, go team, go! Go team! Push them back, way back! And they're doing all this up in heaven. You take yourself all the way to chapter 8, verse 7, and you go back to earth. Have you ever gone to see, on 4th of July, these fireworks, the kind of go up like this, and then they break up, and then one of them goes out and breaks up, and then one of them goes out and breaks up? You know what I'm talking about? Okay, that's what the judgments are like. There are three rounds of judgment, and the first one are the seals, and they go up, and there are six of them that break off. But when the seventh one breaks off, it breaks into another six judgments, and the seventh one breaks into another six judgments, actually seven judgments. And so it kind of opens like that. So the last of the seals opens up into another round of judgment. I drop my eyes now to chapter 8. And when I see in verse 7 that these are a series, or verse 6, these are a series of angels who are carrying trumpets. And this time, instead of breaking seals, it's every time a trumpet player plays, another judgment falls. Follow them through. In 8:7, all the way through chapter 11, verse 14, it says in 8:7 that one third of the earth is pummeled by something that falls hard like hail but blows up when it hits. I'm going to say missile. You can go hail. I'm okay with it. In 8:8, it says one third of all the fresh water of the salt water on the earth is wounded and destroyed. And then in 8:10, it says one third of all the fresh water is destroyed on the earth. And then one third of light and darkness is thrown off, and the planet is getting pummeled. And right in the middle of that, something breaks open from the earth, and out of the middle of the earth comes this demonic horde of locusts that won't kill you, but they'll really put you in a world of hurt. And one third of the men of the earth are killed. And when you step back, you go, wait a minute, what's going on here in chapter 8? See, chapter 8 and 9 are there to tell you that by the time you get to the middle of the tribulation period, it ain't nice out there. It's bad. You know what's interesting? Right in the middle of all of this pummeling of the earth, do you know what people do in reaction? There's this little note John marks. They won't give up their pharmaceuticals. They won't give up their drugs. And right in the middle of it, it's every man for himself. Community is breaking down. This is not going to be a happy time where everybody goes out and sings Kumbaya and waits for Jesus. That's not going to happen. They're going to hate him because stuff is happening and they don't understand why. You know what's interesting? By the time you're done reading this, go to chapter 11, verse 15. Do you know what's going on in heaven? Praise. And you go, wait a minute, are you guys disconnected? We're getting pummeled down here. And here you are up there going, the kingdom of our Lord and of his Christ, he will reign forever and ever. The kingdom of this world has become the kingdom of our Lord and of his Christ, and we shall reign forever and ever. They're singing the hallelujah chorus, and we're getting pounded down here. Well, here's the reason. Because up in heaven, the church of Jesus Christ understands the right of God to finish the human program that began in mutiny and rebellion. Let me just say this. in case you hadn't caught it yet, you won't mutiny and win. Did you ever have an argument with God? Did you ever win? Never got a yes to that question. Not by anybody who knows what they're talking about. Here's the thing. In chapter 12, they take you to Heaven Network News. Chapter 12 is actually a video about the history of the Jewish people in one capsulized video. Here's the thing. John didn't know what was going to happen. To you, it's history. To him, it's prophecy. It hadn't happened yet. And here's the story. In 12:1, there was a woman. She had 12 stars on her head because she represents the wife of the father, Israel. How do I know that? Because she gave birth to a child who is to rule all nations. Who would that be? And when she gave birth to the child who was destined to rule all nations, there was a dragon that wanted to kill the child. Next Christmas, when you sing about the angels appearing over Bethlehem, they were there for a reason. They were guarding the baby. Heavenly host, it's sfaot. It's the word for the army of heaven. Linebacker-size angels up there going like this. Go ahead, make my day. And demons going, not today, Charlie. I think I'll let you go. So what I want you to see is in chapter 12, it says that when, in verse 5, she gave birth to the male child that was going to rule all nations, the dragon tried to kill the kid, but he couldn't get the child, so he went after the mother. That's the story of the anti-Jewish antisemitism that was going to happen. If you can't kill the king, kill the kingdom. God promised them that there would be one sitting on the throne of David that would rule over them. If he can't stop him, he'll stop them. If he can end them, then it won't happen. Then God is wrong. And that's the program. Now, what's interesting to me is in 12 and 13, if you keep going here on the earth, there's an intense suffering. You know what happens in chapter 12? Chapter 12 says God finally says, you know, I'm done with you arguing with me day and night, accusing believers day and night. I am sick of hearing you. And Michael is given the power to throw Satan to the earth. He arrives on earth and boy, is he ticked. And Satan unleashes in the second half of the tribulation period powerful punishment on the earth that makes the first half look easy. If you keep reading, you get down to chapter 16 and you'll find that there's a series of other judgments, the third set. Remember we had seals, then we had trumpets. Now he's dumping the whole bowl. And in 16:2, his worshipers get boils all over them. All the sea dies. All the sea dies. All the fresh water dies in 16:4. The sun is turned up until there's scorching heat on people. And they cry out, stop it. So God shuts it off. And now it's dark. And they cry out, turn it on. And he dries up a river, the Euphrates. And he's drawing in all of the nations to come down on one nation, his estranged bride Israel. And sitting there in a little spot is Israel, surrounded by people, outmanned 40-1, outgunned by the nations of the world that have been dragged into a conflict. They don't even realize why they are there. And here's what I want you to see. Go to 18:20 for a minute. Guess what's going on in heaven? Praise. And you're sitting here going, wait a minute. 17 and 18 are the pummeling of the earth and religious Babylon and commercial Babylon. Those are just symbolic words for the world. The world is going to tie up false religion all together, intimately intertwined to commerce. In the middle of the tribulation period, you will believe what you are told or you will stop eating. You don't get a thing if you don't do what we say. Anybody see that attitude rising? Do what we say, you intolerant people. You know, it's funny because tolerance only seems to work one direction in our society. And in the midst of that, in heaven, they're praising. Why are they praising? Listen to the words in 18:20. Rejoice over her, O heaven. and you saints and apostles and prophets, because God has pronounced judgment for you against her. You know what he says? Commercial, worldly, false religious systems will be broken in 1 hour. I want you to know that from as far back as thousands of years before Jesus, people were dinking out an economy that has been chugging along through Wall Street in bubbles and recessions up and down mankind spread out through all the earth. You can use your ATM card half a world away, stick it in a machine, out pops local cash. They got the technology. They got the belief system. Everybody's walking in lockstep, doing what they're told. And God says, in 1 hour, it's over. That's how long it takes God to destroy human history and all the big things we build. And heaven steps back and says, do you know why we just did that? Because many of my people were executed by these people. And truth was subverted by these. And I won't let that stand. Now, I don't want anybody here to think God was up in heaven having fun killing people. Sit across from the girl that was raped and then dragged into court and raped again judicially and watched him get out with a smirk on his face. And she's so angry. And all I have to give her is Jesus saw it and nobody gets off. Every dog has his day. Know this, you will never suffer that God will not remember. Because a lot of stuff never gets made right here on earth. And you can go out there and you can march for social justice all you want, but there's a lot of people that have been put down wrongly and it never gets fixed here. My joy comes from the fact that here isn't all there is. That it doesn't have to get settled this side of heaven, because there's another side. And there's a righteous judge, and he misses nothing. You know what's interesting? I get up to heaven, and I listen to them praising. I come back to the earth, and in chapters 19 and 20, it opens up a story. It's actually a story of two different meals. That's why it's got my attention. I'm a foodie. The first half of 19 is the marriage supper of the Lamb. This is what's going on, that Jesus' marriage is going on in heaven as the church is gathered around him and his bride becomes one with him. And the second half of the chapter is the supper of the birds. See, right after Jesus' banquet, he hops on a horse. And everybody who's at the banquet hops on a horse with him. If you know Jesus and you're called up to Jesus and you're with Jesus, while the world's getting pummeled, you're having dinner plans. But after dinner, we get a horse. Now, Jesus is going to have to work on my fear of heights. I don't know exactly how it's going to work. All I know is he's going to break through the clouds, and I am 273,000 rows back, 14th from the end, smiling. That's me. And if you're with Jesus, every place he goes, you go. How did you get to heaven? Well, there was a time, one day we were sitting in here talking, and in the middle of that a trumpet sounded, and the dead in Christ rose first, and we which are alive and remain were caught up together with him in the air, and we were ever with him wherever he went, we went. So he had dinner in chapter 19, so we had dinner. And then he got on a horse, so we got on a horse. And he came down to rescue Israel because their back was to the sea. They could not escape. All the nations were coming down on them. They wanted to rid this nation from the earth. So finally they could prove, ha, your God is just a myth. It's some Bronze Age story you throw back. And right in the middle, Jesus showed up. King of Kings, Lord of Lords written on his thigh. And when he comes out of the clouds with all the ones who are in heaven with him, it's the most anticlimactic battle I've ever seen. You know why? My favorite film ever in youth group was Bambi Meets Godzilla. Did you ever see this? It's a great film. It is a great film. It opens with, you know, Bambi out there in the forest. Dee, 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 dee. And then you see this dinosaur foot. Bom! And that says the end. That's it. That's the whole thing. Now, Jesus comes out of the clouds and people are pulling, pull those tanks up, bring those missiles in. Come on, boys, we can do this. And all the world gathers all of its technology. Jesus comes and what it says in 1915 is he speaks and they're done. That's it. Well, that's pretty anticlimactic. What do you think? Because when Jesus talks, he's the king above all kings. Chapter 20 says he grabs Satan, throws him into a dungeon for 1,000 years, sits on the throne of David, and checks off his list of all the promises he made to the Jewish people that he never kept. And after 1,000 years, when Satan wasn't around, he was bound, there was another rebellion. You know why? Because the devil doesn't make you rebel. Your default switch is mutiny. And even without him, you'll still fight. And Jesus comes back. And in chapters 21 and 22, he cleans up the mess, makes a new heaven, and makes a new earth. And the whole story is nothing more and nothing less than showing the exaltation of the King who came and spoke and there was light. He was the agent of creation, of him to him. Through him are all things created. In him all things consist. And he is the very one that will set it right. Everything that was broken will be set back where it belongs. Mutiny will be dialed back. And it will all become what it was intended to be in the beginning of the story. And Jesus will write something on your head. I am. This is who I am. This is the story of who I really am. See, history is his story. I want to close with something that Don Moen wrote. I love it. I've shared it with many people. He wrote it as an introduction to a song back in the 1980s when there were still Afro hairdos. He said, my friend, you can trust God. He is good and he is good all the time. But as you focus on his goodness, don't forget his greatness. He is unparalleled and unprecedented. He is the centerpiece of civilization. He's the superlative of all excellence. He's the sum of human greatness. He's the source of divine grace. His name is the only one able to save and his power is the only one able to cleanse. His ear is open to the sinner's call. His hand is quick to lift the fallen soul. He's the eternal lover of us all, everyone, and you can trust him. He supplies mercy for the struggling soul. He sustains the tempted and the tried. He sympathizes with the wounded and the broken. He heals the sick. He cleanses the leper. He delivers the captive. He defends the helpless. He binds up the brokenhearted. He is for you, and you can trust him. Jesus is the key to all knowledge. He's the wellspring of wisdom. He's the doorway to deliverance. He's the pathway to peace. He's the roadway to righteousness. He's the highway of holiness. He's the gateway to glory. And yes, you can trust him. Jesus is enough. He's the all-sufficient king. He's the king of the Jews. He's the king of Israel. He's the king of righteousness. He's the king of the ages. He's the king of heaven. He's the king of glory. He's the king of kings and the Lord of lords. And you can trust him. Now rejoice, my friend. He is a sovereign king. There is no gauge to measure his limitless love. There is no barrier to block his blessings outpoured. He is enduringly strong and entirely supreme. He is eternally steadfast and immortally faithful. He is imperially powerful and he is impartially merciful. He is Jesus, God's son, and you can trust him. I wish I could more accurately describe him, but he's indescribable. He's incomprehensible. He's invincible. He's irresistible. You can't outlive him and you cannot live without him. The Pharisees couldn't stand him, but they couldn't stop him. Pilate couldn't fault him. Herod couldn't kill him. Death couldn't conquer him and the grave couldn't hold him. My friend, he's the Alpha and Omega, the first and the last. He's the God of our future and the God of our past. So we rise over and over again to speak his name. Jesus, 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 you can trust him. And then he went on to introduce, crown him with many crowns. the Lamb upon his throne. Hark how the heavenly anthem sounds. All music but its own. Awake my soul and sing of him who died for me. And hail him as the matchless king throughout eternity. Lord Jesus, I trust you. You know how to make things right. In Jesus' name. Amen. Woo.